that is UPSC, CSC, State Public Service Commissions, SSC combined graduate level, and also for the CLAT examinations. So do visit AKS IAS Academy and also visit the AKS IAS Academy website. About me, I'm Sandeep Bhushan Tumala, and my credentials are: I have 10 years of teaching experience for civil services. I teach international relations and internal security and analysis of the Hindu newspaper. And this session will definitely help you to crack prelims and mains examinations, because throughout my session, I would be emphasizing on the keywords and the key phrases, which we will be making sure that we will pick up or identify and pick up from the newspaper, that is daily news analysis. So by identifying the keywords and the key phrases in the newspaper, we will identify or will get to the point that we will make sure that we will pick up the factual, analytical, and conceptual questions, which will be very, very useful for the preliminary examination point of view. So by identifying the keywords and the key phrases, we'll definitely get to the point of again screening the factual, analytical, and conceptual questions, which will be useful for the prelims examinations. And by imbibing the keywords and the key phrases, or inculcating the habit of getting into the practice of imbibing the keywords and the key phrases, you will certainly be beneficial in regards to the answer writing, that is in regards to the mains examinations. So definitely the keywords and the key phrases will make you comfortable in the answer writing, that is in the mains examination. And not only being comfortable, but your answers will certainly be precise and concise. And once your answers in the mains are precise and concise, so definitely you will score higher marks in the mains examination. So thereby you will score more marks and you will definitely have an edge over others. So my session, that is in regards to the daily news analysis, will definitely help you to crack both prelims and mains for the year 2020 as well as 2021. And this session is in regards to the daily news analysis, that is today's 14th of August 2020. And here I would reiterate and re-emphasize my tagline, that is emphasizing on the keywords and the key phrases will certainly help you to have a benefit or edge over others, both in prelims as well as mains examination. And also you will certainly be more comfortable in the interview or the personality round of the UPSC, which is the third phase. So definitely the daily news analysis will certainly help you to have edge over others in both prelims, mains, and also in the interview. And before I get into the daily news analysis, I would say a very good morning to all who are in the live and also in the live chat. So good morning to Vijaya, Praveen Kumar, Sohel, Arafat, Harika, Sheikh Mastan, B, Venkat Ramana, Srikant Balu, everyone, very good morning. And also in the live, who are also in the live, very good morning to you all. And I would also request that whoever are in the live but not in the live chat, please try to get into the live chat and also pose your question. Any doubts, please feel free to pose your questions, who are in the live but not in the live chat. Please do come in the live chat and be part of the live chat of AKS IAS Academy Daily News Analysis, and also try to make sure that whatever you have the queries or doubts, please do put in the live chats. So I request the one who is not in the live chat but in the live, do come in the live chat. And the quote of the day is, think big. Think big and don't listen. And don't listen to people who tell you it can't be done. I repeat, think big. Because your thinking has to be very, very big. Your thinking has to be big. And don't listen to people to whom, who tell you, what they tell you, that it can't be done. That means whatever you have thought big, that it can't be done. So to the people who say to you that whatever you have taken up, the challenge or the goal is not achievable, so do not listen to them. Do not listen to them. Life's too short to think small. So as life is so short, so you should never think small. You should always think big. And whenever you are thinking big, and anyone or the people around you who will definitely make you let down by their words saying that it can't be done, that means whatever you have dreamt or your goal which is big cannot be achieved. So do not listen to the people who tell you it can't be done. Why? Because life is too short to think small. So do or think big and achieve big. So this is a quote of the day. Always try to think big. And before I get into the daily news analysis, I would say very good morning to Gopi Nayak, K. Anita, Jasinghe Hanu, Yacharam, Mahesh, Nandita Tepa, D. Suvarna. Very good morning to you all. Welcome. A warm welcome to AKS IAS Academy Daily News Analysis. Now I'll get into the topic, that is PM announces taxpayers charter. So here the keyword, definitely we will focus on the keyword, that is the taxpayers charter. The keyword here is taxpayers charter. So what do you mean by charter? Charter are the rules and regulations, or the norms, or the rules and regulations. So the keyword for us to focus is the taxpayers charter. So definitely our Prime Minister Narendra Modi has gone ahead with launching, he has launched transparent taxation and honoring the honest. I repeat, he has launched a platform. He has launched a platform, and that platform is called as transparent taxation. Transparent taxation, and that would honor the honest. Who? Honest taxpayers. Honest, who are the one who are being honored? They are the one who are honoring the honest taxpayers. So the government of India is very clear in regards to launching the platform, that is the transparent taxation and honoring the honest is the one, the platform which has been launched. And what does it provide? It provides faceless assessment, it provides faceless appeal assessment, it provides faceless appeal, that means you can appeal without your presence, and then taxpayers charter. So these are the one which the platform, that is the transparent taxation, that is honoring the honest, is being launched by our Prime Minister. And definitely this is launched, this platform is launched, making sure that it will instill in the sense, it will create a kind of sense. What kind of sense it will create? It will create a fairness and fearless. These are all very, very important keywords. So the Prime Minister, which he has come up with a new platform, creates a kind of fairness. Fairness means there is no transparency and there would be fearlessness in the taxpayers. And he has made it very clear that the government of India, that is the government of India, in the last 6 years, they have focused on various sectors, that is banking on the unbanked, securing on the unsecured, funding on the unfunded, and now the government is really worried about honoring the honest. So look at all the keywords. Please do understand all the keywords. So the keywords here, what our Prime Minister is making it very clear, that he has come up with a platform that is transparent taxation and honoring the honest. And in the last 6 years, the government has focused on banking on unbanked. This is what you mean by banking on unbanked. That is in regards to the complete financial inclusion. That means every household will have a bank account. Financial inclusion. It is called as financial inclusion. And securing the unsecured. So definitely it is all regards to the welfare schemes. Through the direct benefit transfer. And funding the unfunded. So definitely here also in regards to making sure that what we discussed yesterday, street vendors or micro, small and medium enterprises, by the stimulus package, they are funding the unfunded, that is the entrepreneurs or the startups also. So now the honoring the honest is for the taxpayers. So definitely you need to focus on what the government has focused on. It has focused on banking on unbanked one and then securing the unsecured one, funding the unfunded people, and now they honoring the honest. And this scheme, that is in regards to the platform, the new platform which has been launched, is the transparent taxation honoring the honest, will be launched on September 5th. Why on September 5th? Because it is the birth anniversary of Deen Dayal Upadhyay. So as September 5th is the birth anniversary of Deen Dayal Upadhyay, so the face will be available from the September 24th. No doubt it has been launched, but the faceless appeal system, so which will be part of the transparent taxation honoring the honest, the faceless appeal, the second one, the faceless appeal system will be available from September 5th, because the date falls as the birth anniversary of the Deen Dayal Upadhyay. So here it is a very important one, or the platform which has been launched. So do understand the importance of the transparent taxation honoring the honest. Why? Again, definitely it is part of self-reliance. Why? Because the government of India or the Prime Minister of India is definitely asking the one who are able to pay the tax, so that they have to pay the tax and be part of the self-reliance or be part of the Atmanirbhar Bharat. Before I get into the next slide, Vani, Madhu, Malvika, Sachivan, Asmat Khan, Mohammed, and Shravani, yes, have joined. Very warm welcome to you all to AKS IAS Academy Daily News Analysis. And the assessment system. So because we spoke about assessment system or appeal system, and then we also spoke about assessment faceless appeal or faceless appeal, faceless assessment and taxpayer charters. So faceless appeal. This is faceless appeal, and then faceless assessment and taxpayer's charter. So if you look at this faceless assessment system, what does it do? It eliminates. So the main intention of the assessment system, faceless assessment system, is to what? To eliminate the corrupt practices. So the main intention of the assessment system is to eliminate corrupt practices. Assess. So what the government of India through the concerned department will assess? It will assess whether there are any corrupt practices. And by this system, that is assessment system, will eliminate all the corrupt practices. And also they are going ahead with reviewing the data. So definitely the data, that is the one who have filed the or who are paying the, or the taxpayers, their data would be reviewed, and that data would be randomly chosen, so that reviewing of the data will take place by using the concepts called as data analytics and artificial intelligence. These two are important because review of orders will be done by another team, which will be chosen randomly by using the data analytics and the artificial intelligence. Please do understand these two, because with this are being taken up by the use or the help of technology. So now the technology is also being used in regards to eliminating the corrupt practices. How? In regards to the scrutiny, they go ahead with the scrutiny. How the scrutiny take place? That take place randomly. How it takes place randomly? By review of orders. Please do understand. Scrutiny, it takes place because of random allocation. How the random allocation takes place? By review of orders. How this review of orders, everything is taken place? By usage of technology. What kind of technology? Data analytics and artificial intelligence. Why all this? To eliminate corrupt practices. And this is part of what? Faceless assessment system. That means you need not be really a present wherein your face is required, but it is faceless. That means it could be virtually. You can have everything assessment, and then also you can appeal, you can assess, you can appeal, which is virtually. And these are all very important. The keywords what we have looked at: data analytics, artificial intelligence, part of technology, and faceless assessment system, because to eliminate corrupt practices. And PM Modi, as we looked at, he has launched transparent taxation, honoring the honest. Please do understand this keyword, honoring the honest. Why? The one who are the taxpayers or the honest. So the honest taxpayers would be honored. And number of taxpayers is significant. See, look at this. The number of taxpayers in India is only 1.5 crores, but the population is 130 crore. That means the taxpayers are very low. So making sure that the government of India or the Prime Minister has launched this transparent taxation, honoring the honest, is expecting this 1.5 crore taxpayers count will be increased. Now it is very low. And this is definitely to build Atmanirbhar Bharat. Why? Because we wanted to be self-reliant. When we wanted to be self-reliant, we wanted the eligible taxpayers to pay the tax to the government, so that would be added to the self-reliant India. That is Atmanirbhar Bharat. Atmanirbhar Bharat. As he said that the government has focused on banked on unbanking, securing the unsecured, funding the unfunded, and now honoring the honest. So this is very important in regards to the scheme taken up, and this is, again I am saying, it is part of Atmanirbhar Bharat scheme. And here what is important is that we have looked at faceless appeal, we have looked at faceless assessment, fine, and also now the taxpayers charter. So what does this emphasize? That is taxpayers charter. Charter in the sense rules and regulations. So this is definitely, the taxpayers charter will definitely help in regards to the country's development or development of the economy. How? It will make sure that it will bring a balance between the taxpayers. So it will definitely bring balance between, this is very, very important conceptual, balance between the taxpayers and the government. Taxpayers and government. How? Because in regards to the taxpayers, it will make sure that it will create a kind of sense, what kind of duty the taxpayers have, what kind of responsibility that the taxpayers have. Please do understand, this is very important that you can put it in your mains answer as a short notes. You can add it there. Why? Because Here it is conceptual. And in regards to government, what it will create a balance between the transparency, taxpayers and government. The government should feel responsibility. So when the government feels responsibility, along with the taxpayer, along with the taxpayers feel the duty and responsibility. Thereby, it will create, or it is a vital step. Thereby, it is a vital step for the nation's development. Taxpayers' charter. It is talking about the duties and responsibility of the taxpayers and the responsibility of the both the duties and also responsibilities of the government. So definitely, it is bringing the balance between both of them, and definitely the trust transparency of the tax, that is in regards to the new platform which has been brought up, it will have, or it will strengthen the minimum government and maximum governance. Minimum government, what the government says, that it is always says that it is minimum government and maximum governance. So that means it says that government intervention will be minimum, but government action will be maximum. That is, the end result to reach the citizens would be maximum. That is what it says. And the new facility will definitely further strengthen the government's motto. This is the motto of the government. What is the motto of the government? Minimum government and maximum governance. And definitely, Prime Minister Narendra Modi has appealed to those who are not paying the taxes to come forward and then commit themselves to pay the taxes. Why? Because by paying the taxes, the country will become self-reliant. As part of Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan, we wanted everyone who are not paying the taxes but who have the ability to pay the tax, they should come forward and commit themselves to pay the taxes to make India a self-reliant India. That is part of Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan. So Shankar has joined, Rakesh has joined, David Paul, very good morning to you. Warm welcome to you all in regards to the daily news analysis by AKSIS Academy. So please do understand, the platform which has been launched by the Prime Minister of India, that is transparent taxation, honoring the honest. This would be very much in regards to the economy, or again in regards to the schemes, that is Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan or self-reliant India. So we have faceless assessment, faceless appeal, and then taxpayers charter. These three are the main in the entire keywords. And Shiva has joined, Kavita Mahato has also joined. A warm welcome to you, both of you, to Daily News Analysis of AKSIS Academy. And now we'll get into the another news which talks about write prescriptions in capital letters. So definitely this is an order by the Orissa High Court. By the Orissa High Court, it has given an order to the state government, and the state government, that is the state government through the chief secretary, and through the chief secretary it has to be to the Medical Council of India, and thereby the doctors should implement, or should implement writing legibly. That is, which can be read, and it has to be written in capital letters. So the Orissa High Court very clearly says that it is difficult to decipher. Decipher means understand. So the Orissa High Court makes it very clear that the finding of the medical records, finding of the medical records, which the High Court feels that it is very difficult to understand the writing or the prescription of the doctors and it has directed the state government to issue a circular asking the doctors to write prescriptions in capital letters, because it is, the prescriptions are pathetically poor legibility. That means the legibility, that means understanding is not, understanding the prescription by the doctors are very poor to decipher it. That is why the Orissa High Court has directed the state government through the chief secretary that the doctors should be issued a circular so that the doctors should write the prescriptions in the capital letters and in an, that it should not create an unambiguous manner. That means something else we would think about the prescription. And it is illegible handwriting, and it did, the Orissa High Court has made it very clear that because this illegible handwriting would create or would bring in a point wherein it would be a life-threatening consequences. Why? Because if it is not correctly deciphered by the pharmaceuticals or from the pharmacist, so there might be a possible that some other drug might be given and that would create a life-threatening consequences. Why? Because of the illegible handwriting. That is why the High Court has directed the state government asking the doctors to write the capital letters. So what is the other point that we need to understand for the prelims point of view is that the judgment, that is the Orissa High Court, has quoted a notification of the Orissa High Court has quoted a notification of Medical Council of India. Which has issued on September 21, 2016. So this is very important for us for prelims point of view, because there might be a very grim situation of asking about Orissa's High Court decision on the legibility or the handwriting of the doctors, but they might be focused on the notification of the issued by the Medical Council of India on September 21, 2016. What it has issued, that it has directed, the physicians in the sense the doctors, that their prescriptions writing about the drugs or the generic names of the drugs has to be in capital letter. Please do understand. So this is not the first time wherein the doctors are being asked to write the prescription legibly, especially the names of the drugs and the generic names. It should be in capital letters, not the first time. But in 2016 itself, the Medical Council of India has asked or directed the physicians to write the names of the drugs and the generic names of the drugs in capital letters. And now again in 2020, it is the Orissa High Court. 2016, it is the Medical Council of India. So this is the core of our explanation. Medical Council of India, 2016, it has directed the doctors or the physicians, and Orissa High Court has directed the state government to issue a circular that the doctors write the prescription in the capital letters. That is in the year 2020 August. So this is August 2020. This is September 2016. This is very important. And the other one is, judgment also reads that the digital era, in the digital era, could also throw open several questions or options to make prescriptions and the diagnosis more patient friendly. So it has to be, even at the time of digital era, it is very important that it has to be, the diagnosis has to be, or else the prescription and the diagnosis of which have been in regards to the health has to be more patient friendly. So look at it. The Orissa High Court has linked or taken into consideration of the digital era. Digital era, wherein in the digital era, it also makes it very clear that the prescriptions and the diagnosis have to be patient friendly. So look at it. It is also concentrating on the distal area as well as the patient, being patient friendly. So whatever the prescriptions by the doctors have to be patient friendly, and it should not be a life threatening consequences. So this is very important, because not only the Orissa High Court direction, but also the MCI, Medical Council of India, directing the physicians in the year September 2016. And before I get in the next topic, Samuel UMR creation and the Ram Kumar Alwala has also joined. Warm welcome to you all to AKSIS Academy daily news analysis. And there is another news which talks about India announces 500 million package for the Maldives. So here it is in regards to the having or giving assistance or providing assistance. India providing assistance or announcing the financial package to the Maldives. So in regards to what the project they would go ahead is called as Greater Male Connectivity Project. Again, this is very important for prelims point of view. Greater Male Connectivity Project. So here the government of India has announced 500 million package for Maldives. And why all this? Because there would be a new, this is because of the new connectivity measure. So it is part of the new connectivity measure. The government of India or India has gone ahead with providing or announcing 500 million package to Maldives as new connectivity measure. And this connectivity will be in regards to the air, sea and intra island. So there are various islands in Maldives. So there would be a connectivity between the islands, and then air connectivity and sea connectivity as well as telecommunications. So these are all very important, that for the prelims point of view, what is that measure, under which measure the government has announced 500 million package for the assistance of Greater Male Connectivity Project. So it is Greater Male or Greater. We are looking at the expansion of the Male, that is in Maldives. So it is air, sea, intra island and telecommunication. And this will definitely make sure that, why the government is going ahead? Because the government is going ahead with, in an effort to help Indian Ocean Island. So it is India has gone ahead with announcing 500 million package for the Maldives because of the new connectivity measure. Under that, it will also help the Indian Ocean Islands. This will help Indian Ocean Islands. How it will help? It will help in regards to the to deal with the economic impact. This is very important, to deal with the economic impact of COVID-19 pandemic situation. So definitely a very good initiative deal taken to help the Indian Ocean Islands. The new connectivity measure will help the Indian Ocean Islands to deal with the economic impact of COVID-19 pandemic. This is very important phrase, to deal with the economic impact of the COVID-19 pandemic of the Indian Ocean Islands. Please do understand, of the Indian Ocean Islands. And what are the initiatives which have been taken up in regards to the new connectivity measures is that there would be a connectivity bubble for travel. So this is the keyword, connectivity bubble. So definitely, as we said, air, sea. So air connectivity, it is bubble. And then in regards to the sea, it is ferry service. That is through water, ferry service. And there would be a submarine cable also for telecom. So we have looked at for telecom also. So for telecommunication, there would be a submarine cable. And then to make sure that all the three neighboring islands, which are what you say, connecting or close to Malay will be connected, and that is called as greater Malay connectivity. So Malay and the other three neighboring islands, Malay and other three neighboring islands, and this could be based a question for the prelims from geography map based or geography map based prelims point of view, because there could be a question that the greater Malay connectivity project is to connect Malay and which of the following islands, Malay with which among the following three islands. So that is very important for prelims point of view. Do not just take it very light. It is very necessary that there could be possibility in regards to the relations, bilateral relations between India and Maldives, or it could be in regards to the economy, that providing the economic package of announcing 500 million package, which is line of credit. So economy point of view, again geography map based point of view, that it would be asked that Malay and then connect it with the three neighboring islands. So this is very important, how you need to focus or analyze the news, that is in regards to the new connectivity measures for greater assistance to the greater Malay connectivity projects with the other three connecting neighboring islands connecting Malay. So here it is air, here it is sea, and then it is telecom, and intra-island connectivity. Please do understand, I am making it very clear once again and repeating how you need to link it. Just once you read, it will be out of your mind, it will not store. So I said air connectivity, sea connectivity, intra-island and telecommunication. Air connectivity because of the bubble connectivity for travel, air connectivity bubble, and then ferry is the sea, submarine cable is for telecommunication, and then the greater Malay connectivity project is intra-island, that is Malay with the other three neighboring islands. This is very important to understand it for the prelims point of view. I would guarantee that you will not miss a question if asked in the prelims in regards to this. And before I get into the next slides, Lokesh Chandra has joined, Prithviraj has joined. Very good morning to both of you and a warm welcome to AKSIS Academy Daily News Analysis. And this financial package or the assistance by India to Maldives in regards to the Greater Malay Connectivity Project is consisting a grant of $100 million and a new line of credit of $400 million. So this $400 million line of credit is in addition to the previous what we have given or line of credit in 2018, $800 million. So in 2018, the line of credit from India to Maldives is $800 million. And again now 2020, the line of credit from India to Maldives is an additional $400 million. So what is important is you need to understand how India is actually giving the financial package to Maldives. So it has given the financial package in 2018 of $800 million line of credit, and now again it is 2020 August, $400 million. So all this in regards to the greater Malay connectivity project would be the largest civilian infrastructure project in Maldives. So which among the following is the largest civilian infrastructure project in Maldives is the greater Malay connectivity project. And because of this project, there would be bridges and causeways to connect Malay. I said intra connectivity. One of them is intra connectivity, air, sea, telecom, air, sea, and telecom. I said telecommunication, and the fourth one is intra. So intra is Malay with, this is very important, Malay with Willingly or Shangri-La. It is also called as Shangri-La. And Willingrilla, along with the island, the other island is Thilafushi, and the third island is Gulifahu Island. So these islands are very important for geography or the current affairs. Current affairs general in regards to the connectivity or economy or the infrastructure, that is financial package provided for the Greater Male Connectivity Project. Or geography point of view, from geography point of view, which are the islands which are being connecting Male is Willingly, that is Shangri-La or Thilafushi, and then Gulifahu Islands. These are the one which are just a span of 6.7 kilometers from Male to all this connectivity. This is very, very important. Please do understand. This is how your focus or your preparation has to be from each and every nook and corner of what UPSC might frame a question. So Male to Willingly, Thilafushi, and then Gulifahu Islands. Please do understand the line of credit, 800 million in 2018 and 2020, 400 million units. And if you look at this, see, I have taken for you a benefit, that is, this is Thilafushi Islands and then Gulifahu Islands, and this is Male. Male. So you will have connectivity with Male, and then this is the first one which I said, Willingly Island. So this is Willingly, or it is also called as Shangri-La. So please do understand the islands for the geography map based questions for prelims point of view. So this is Male, and then the left of Male, or else you can say the north of Male is Willingly, and then again Gulifahu Islands, and then Thilafushi Islands. So this connectivity from here, it would be a connectivity to this island, intra, right? Again from Willingly to Gulifahu, and from Gulifahu to Thilafushi Islands. So this is Greater Male Connectivity Project. This is how you need to prepare your preparation for the prelims point of view, micro level. This is micro level preparation, and these are taken for your benefit, which will be very, very useful for you in regards to the geography map based questions. So this is Thilafushi Islands, Gulifahu Islands, Willingly Islands, Shangri-La, and this is Male. And the other news is, consider more languages in government, which has been said by Chief Justice of India. So the Chief Justice of India, Sharad A. Bobde, has made it very clear that he is asking the government, or he has said the government, that the government of India should consider amending, please do understand, he did not say, it says the government should consider to amend. Amend what? And this is being told by the Chief Justice of India. Who is the Chief Justice of India? S. A. Bobde. Or Sharad A. Bobde. He said that there can be a possibility that the government should consider amending what? Amending the Official Languages Act of 1963. Again, this is very, very important for prelims point of view. So look at it. The Chief Justice of India has made a statement or asked the government to amend, but again for prelims point of view, we have to focus what? Official Languages Act 1963. And why the Supreme Court or else the Chief Justice of India has asked the government to consider amending the Official Languages Act? that he wanted that include or inclusion of more vernacular languages. What do you mean by vernacular? That is local languages or other languages. Vernacular is local or other languages, rather in the sense instead of what we have now, that only Hindi and English. So rather than only English and Hindi, the Chief Justice of India is asking the government to consider amending the Official Languages Act 1963, wherein it wanted to include other vernacular languages rather than what we have right now, only Hindi and English. So vernacular languages that the CJI is asking to include it. Why these Supreme Court or else the Chief Justice of India has come up with this statement? Because there was an appeal which was filed by the Union of India challenging the legality of Delhi High Court. So who has filed the case? Please do understand, it is the Union of India itself. Please do understand, there was an appeal or petition filed by the Union of India itself, that is the government of India itself, in the Supreme Court. Why it has filed an appeal in the Supreme Court? Because the Union of India has or wanted or is challenging the Delhi High Court judgment. So we will look at what is the judgment by the Delhi High Court. So what was the judgment given by the Delhi High Court? That it was not liked by the Union of India, and wherein the Union of India has challenged the Delhi High Court judgment in the Supreme Court, and thereby the Supreme Court, that is the Chief Justice of India, has asked the government to consider amending the Official Languages Act. And now we will get into the what is actually the Delhi High Court judgment. So Delhi High Court judgment is that it has given a judgment on June 30, 2020, that it wanted the government to translate the draft. Please do understand, again this is, please do look at, now we are linking the polity point of it with the ecology and environment. Polity is what the Supreme Court, the Chief Justice of India is considering or wanting the government to consider. This is polity, and ecology and environment we are linking it. Why? Because the Delhi High Court judgment wanted the government of India to translate the draft of environmental impact assessment notification 2020. I have said this in my previous classes. So the government, the Delhi High Court judgment was to translate the draft of the environmental impact assessment notification 2020, that it wanted to government of India to translate the draft into 22 languages. This is very important, into 22 languages, as the 22 languages are being mentioned in the 8th schedule. This is again important for polity point of view. So the languages, how many languages? 22 languages. So 22 languages are mentioned in which schedule? In the 8th schedule. So as per that, the Delhi High Court has given a judgment that the Union or the Government of India should translate the draft into 22 languages, which is mentioned in the 8th schedule. And that decision or the judgment was challenged by the Union government in the Supreme Court. And what did the Supreme Court say? Supreme Court has said that we do not object. Please do understand, this is a very strong message to the government of India. We do not object the High Court judgment. So the Supreme Court is saying that we will not overturn the judgment of the Delhi High Court in regards to asking the government of India to translate the draft into 22 languages, which are part of the 8th schedule of the Indian Constitution. So there are Here the keywords are in regards to the polity point of view and also in regards to the ecology point of view. So amending, wanted to amend the Official Languages Act 1963 and then Environmental Impact Act, Impact Assessment Draft 2020 and Vernacular Languages 22 in the 8th schedule. So this is very important. And what the Supreme Court has said is, it has given a permission to the Government of India or the Union of India to withdraw. It has given permission for the Union of India, which has filed a petition, to withdraw and return to the High Court and file a review petition in the High Court. So look at it. Here again, polity. So the Supreme Court has asked the Union of India to withdraw the petition. To withdraw the petition. Not only that, it wanted the Union of India to file a review petition. To file a review petition where? To file a review petition in Delhi High Court. Fine. And if the Delhi High Court, if the review plea is failed in the Delhi High Court, if the review plea by the Union of India is failed, then you come back. Then you come back to Supreme Court. Please do understand. Please do understand. It's a very good, conceptual which you need to understand. So the government or else the CJI has the, or the Apex Court, Supreme Court has told the Solicitor General Tushar Mehta on behalf of the Union of India, that is the Solicitor General was actually taking up the case, Tushar Mehta, and it has asked Tushar Mehta or the Union of India to withdraw the case and then go ahead with review petition in the Delhi High Court itself. And if the review petition in the Delhi High Court, go ahead with the review plea there, and if the review plea is filed, then come back to the Supreme Court. So look at it, it is wanting the Union of India to follow the procedure. Look at it, the way the Supreme Court is asking the Union of India in regards to challenging the Delhi High Court verdict on translating the draft of the Environmental Impact Assessment Notification 2020 into 22 languages. So it is asking, do follow the procedure, that is review petition. And when we are talking about the Environmental Impact Assessment, it is concerned in regards to, it is definitely in concerned in regards to the environmental restrictions on building, on expansion and modernization of major infrastructure projects. So definitely we can get this into more, that is environmental impact assessment. So what would be the impact of the infrastructure project, what would be the impact of the infrastructure project on the environment, and that would be assessed. So assessment of the environmental impact on the, making sure that it will be having an impact on the environment, and that it wanted to make sure that it will have a greater say in regards to the modernization of the infrastructure project. And what it is wanting is that the environmental impact should reach the maximum number of people without discrimination to any part of the country, that is not even Hindu speaking. So definitely translating has to take place, translation has to take place in 22 languages, so that it will not create any kind of discrimination in the entire country, wherein you have the non-Hindi speaking people. You have the non-Hindi speaking people. So definitely it has to reach and understood by the rural population. What? The Environmental Impact Assessment Notification Draft 2020. That is what the High Court is actually trying to make or understand, that it is because of this. And it wanted to ensure that there would be maximum public participation in regards to the drafting of the environmental impact assessment, so that they will respond with maximum suggestions, and if there are any objections, they will raise the objection. Why? Because of the non-Hindi speaking people across the country, wherein they should not feel discriminated when it is only in the Hindi and English. So it has to be included in the 22 languages as per the 8th schedule. So this is very, very important. What the CGI has made it very clear, and this is in regards to polity and again in regards to the ecology and environment. And there is another news which talks about Navy should design and develop armaments. So that we have seen that the Defense Minister or Rajnath Singh has made it very clear that he has gone ahead with making sure that the imports would be reduced. Imports would be reduced and then exports would be increased. And there we have looked at, again this is Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan. So this is again in regards to the self-reliance, right? And then in regards to this, now the Defense Minister Rajnath Singh has gone ahead with launching of Indian Naval Innovation and Indigenous Organization. So it is NIIO. Again, this is very important in regards to the prelims point of view. So the Defense Minister Rajnath Singh has virtually launched what? Indian Naval Innovation and Indigenous Organization. So whenever you come across this word indigenous, it is nothing but self-reliant. That is Atmanirbhar Abhiyan Bharat scheme. So definitely it is Indian Naval Innovation and Indigenous Organization. And what it will go ahead is, it will get into the mode of focusing on this. Indian Naval Innovation and Indigenous Organization will focus on design and development. It will focus on design and development of armaments, that is the weapons. It will focus on design and development of armaments and that will make sure that it is in a significant progress in regards to the indigenous. So when we are talking about indigenous, that is in regards to the, what we were talking about, indigenous manufacturing units in regards to the design of warships, So this NIIO will be a dedicated structure which will include, or it will interact academicians and industries. For what? For fostering, that is for increasing. What it will increase? It will increase the innovation. It will increase the innovation and indigenization. So innovation and indigenization. Innovation and indigenization will be fostering, and it will create what? Self-reliance. As I said, self-reliance and Atmanirbhar Abhiyan Bharat. That is in regards to self-reliance in what? This is self-reliance in defense. So this is very important, wherein the government, that is the Defense Minister, has launched Naval Innovation and Indigenous Organization, and it is a three-tiered organization, and it will focus on innovation and indigenization, and it is in regards to the self-reliance in defense, part of the vision of Atmanirbhar Bharat. And you also have another one called as Technological Developmental Acceleration Cell. You also have a Technology development acceleration cell, and this has been created for what? Induction. Induction in the sense accepting what? Emerging disruptive technology, and this is, or it will focus on emerging disruptive technology against enemy in an accelerated time frame. So the technology development acceleration cell will induct or focus on emerging disruptive technology, emerging disruptive technology, and which it will be in a very limited or accelerated fast time frame will be taken up. And here it will focus on building of the ships and the submarines, on the submarines. So now India will go ahead with building or built the Indian shipyards in Kochi. That will, it will go ahead with the building of the ships and also the submarines, that is nuclear submarines also. So definitely self-reliant defense, Indian defense is in the verge on the basis of the vision of Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan scheme. And definitely the Navy has signed 4 memorandum of understanding with Uttar Pradesh Expressway Industrial Development Authority, with Uttar Pradesh Expressway Industrial Developmental Authority, and the other one is the Navy has signed is with the Raksha Shakti University, Raksha Shakti University, which is in Gujarat. This is again prelims point of view. In which among the following states is Raksha Shakti University located? It is in Gujarat. And Maker Village. Maker Village in the sense, what maker are we talking about? It is in regards to the ships and submarines. So it is in Kochi. These are all again very important for prelims point of view. And fourth memorandum of understanding is with the Society of Indian Defense Manufacturers. So the 4 memorandum of understandings, the Navy has gone ahead with the UP Expressway Industrial Developmental Authority, and then the Raksha Shakti University, which is in Gujarat, and then Maker, what, which makers are they? Ship building and marine, nuclear submarine, which is in Kochi, and then the Society of Indian Defense Manufacturers. So this is again part of the self-reliant in defense on the sidelines of the vision of Atmanirbhar Bharat. So it has come up with the new launch of the project, that is Naval Innovation and Indigenous Organization. So this is, I hope this was an informative, knowledgeable session wherein we are focused on the taxpayers' charters. Again, this is very important in regards to the scheme. Again, scheme on the sidelines of Atmanirbhar Bharat, that is self-reliant India. Fine. And here in regards to the Supreme Court verdict, we have looked at quality point of view. Again, wherein Medical Council of India 2016, and then again Orissa High Court 2020. Asking the doctors to prescribe in the capital letters. And then this is in regards to the bilateral relations between India and Maldives. India and Maldives we have looked at. And this again in regards to the geography, map based also we have focused. And this in regards to the polity we have focused. And also in regards to the ecology and environment. Ecology and environment. And this one again in regards to the defense. Defense, this is again in regards to the self-reliance in defense, and part of vision, it is a part of vision, what, which vision? Atmanirbhar or Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan vision it is. So we are focused from prelims as well as also mains point of view wherever it is required. So I hope this was very important, informative and knowledgeable session to you all. And then I would certainly say a big thank you and a good luck to you all. A big thank you and a good luck to you all. And before you, I mean the one who are in the live and also in the live chat, before you, you sign off, do like, share and subscribe the AKS IAS Academy Daily News Analysis channel. and then that is Advanced Knowledge System IAS Academy. You can also visit the website of AKS IAS Academy and also do subscribe the Telegram link of AKS IAS Academy. And I would say once again that we will, or I would see you tomorrow 7:30 a.m. And my emphasis once again is that in the midst of your entire, okay, Shravan is asking mains question, definitely I will give it today, because in regards to today's editorials and articles, I thought the redundancy was there. So whenever there is redundancy, so I will not take up the question once again, because just for giving the question, I do not like. So there has to be, that is what, because today's article did not really focus on the questions which I felt would be useful for the mains. So I will take up tomorrow. I will take up tomorrow. Prithvi and then Malvika, Shravani have asked. Do not worry. I will definitely have in my mind. And then do maintain consistency. Stick to your schedule. And then take care of your physical and mental health. So I would say a very big thank you to you all also. Thank you all, and then see you tomorrow at 7:30 a.m.